Thanks, Ishara, for the introduction. So usually I get this slot at the end to deliver a keynote, and it's a challenge to deliver a keynote at this point because it's three long days and you guys are really tired. I'm not really tired, like you guys are overloaded with information. So before I explain about my objectives, let's look at what happened during these 3 days. So the first day, we had tutorials. Basically, we dig in deep into the products and then look at what kind of functionalities and what kind of features provided by these products. And then we look at the tool set, what are the tools available with the products, and got our hands dirty. So that's what happened in the first day. Then the first day of the conference, Sanjeeva gave a really really good keynote with by setting a foundation, explain about the WSO2 architecture, not only the technical architecture, about our culture, how we operate, and gave a really good foundation for the conference. And then after that, Nigel and Isabel explain about the strategy to build a digital platform, what sort of a strategy that you should build, and explain in from the digital platform side of it as well as from the analytic side of it. After that, we divided into different tracks. Basically, I call them as ingredients to build a digital platform. So we talk about various topics like integration, APIs, analytics, cloud, so on and so forth. Even today morning, we had the same format. We had four parallel tracks and discuss about these different technology areas. Then after that, there was a great panel about how you can leverage WSO2 technologies and build different platforms and then provide solutions. And then after that, Venura did a really good keynote on how you can build a vertical platform using WSO2 specifically on the telco side. So my objective here, since you are information overloaded, try to simplify these technologies that and the other information you gathered and help you to take it to the next level and use it in your projects. So that's the main objective. And then share some of the experience, because I work with customers very closely, people who are building the digital platforms or in the digital transformation. So I thought of share some of the experience, because we can take them as good practices. To start with, I'll give an explanation about what I think, what is digital experience. So Sanjeeva gave experience during his keynote, and then Nigel gave his view of what is digital experience. So this is my version of it. So I'm going to use some day-to-day real-life experience to explain the digital experience. So the first one is Uber. So I think Uber is really popular here as well, and most of the countries Uber operates. So it's kind of changed the way we it's kind of changed the entire way how we handle the ground transportation if you are using taxis a lot. So as a person who visit a lot of customers, usually when I visit customers, I used to rent a car those days. But now I rarely rent a car because Uber provides a better service for me and it's very flexible. Because you don't need to pay for your driver. Everything is set up with your account. And then it's providing a better experience than a taxi. How it works, basically, everything is digitized, like even the bill, you get a digital bill that if you are uploading your bills into another system, you can just forward it to the system and get it done. And then you know what type of vehicle coming. And then even you know the driver who's driving the vehicle. And even driver get to know who's my passenger. So there's a connectivity even before you see the driver. So that's the difference you get as a first level experience. Then after you get into the Uber, the way Uber operates, there's a, you can rate how is the service. And when I'm picking picking an Uber, I can check what's the rating for this particular driver. So every driver is keen on giving a better service to get a better rating. So as soon as I get into the Uber, they even ask whether I need a water bottle and then what sort of music that I like to listen, so and so forth. So it's a totally different experience that we get compared with the normal taxi. And the second experience about this device called Amazon Dash, it's about reordering. So in most of the consumer goods, we reorder. And I am a fan of reorder because I have a way that if I get stuck to something, I usually reorder it. So my wife hates to go out and eat with me because I usually go to the same restaurant and then he'd take the same plate. So that's how it is. So I really like this device because of that I can quickly reorder the stuff that I want. So how does it work? Basically, this device, you have to configure it first, and then you can stick it in your washing machine. So even a 6-year-old kid, this is my daughter actually, she's trying to press the button and reorder it, but luckily she's not tall enough to press the button, so she can't order it. So even a kid can order it once you configure. And how smart it is, if the kid or somebody who's trying to order do double click or try to press it twice, then the device send the information to the backend system, and backend system look at whether this is my buying pattern. If it is not buying pattern, it will inform me whether it should reorder or not before it places the order in the system. So that's how the Amazon Tide works. And it's not only for washing powder. Most of the consumer goods are available as a device that you can purchase a device, configure it, and then stick somewhere. And just from a single press, you can reorder. Same day or following day, you will get the goods in your doorstep. So the next experience is about this Amazon Echo, or we call it as Alexa. So we use this heavily at home. I have Alexa, I have an Amazon Echo in my kitchen counter. So kids use it a lot, that they ask different questions about history, geography, different type of things that they need to know from the device, and device give a quick answer. A detailed answer quickly, and then they use that information. Luckily, they don't know that Echo can do math, so they don't use it yet. So that's one experience. And the second experience, I can link the Echo with the Dash. So without going and pressing the button, I can tell Alexa, reorder the kitchen towel, so whatever the consumer good that I want to do. And then I use it in the morning, especially mornings are really rush. So how is the weather? How is the traffic? All these questions can ask while we are working on the stuff. And it provides the necessary information for us and making the life easy. So the next example is about the smart car. I don't drive a Tesla, but one of my colleagues who drives a Tesla explained this story. The first experience he explained after he got the vehicle, he's living in a place in Redwood City, so that road is not that great, and Tesla doesn't have a good road space. So when he passes a certain location, he has to lift the vehicle. So he bought the vehicle, he drove it, and then first day he lifted the vehicle by pressing the button, second day he pressed the button and lift the vehicle. But third day, when he came near that particular location, vehicle automatically lifted. So it identified his driving pattern, and it identified where he is, and then did that particular action for him without he get involved with that. So he shared another experience, because he's very bad with dates. And one day he get into the vehicle, it told him, it's your wife's birthday, and shall I navigate to this particular mall that he usually go. So it identify his wife's birthday from his calendar, and then it identify his driving pattern, where he usually go to shop, and then it helps us because it saves his day, assume if he forget that particular day without taking a present to his wife, how will be the situation. So those are the digital experience that we'll see. And what I want to highlight, it's not the usual customer experience that we experienced before. It has gone beyond the as the people who we provide services for the consumers. We need to count that, because that is the demand and that is the expectation the consumers looking from the services that we provide today. So the next section, actually, I'm going to explain a little bit about the architecture, what are the things internally we have in the digital enterprise. It's not about the technical architecture, it's about the business architecture of this particular experience. The first thing is about customer experience. So it's about customer experience. It's personalized for this person. All the examples that I explained earlier, it's personalized. It's based on me, how I operate, and where I go, all this information gathered, and then give a personalized information for me. And then the next thing is it's real time. Because if it is not real time, there's no value. I need that particular information as soon as example, when I ask from Alexa, it has to give the weather within a few seconds, because otherwise that information is not relevant. So it has to be real time. And then the next thing is it has to be geosensitive, because even the example I took about the Tesla, it lifted the car by identifying where he is located, so it has to be geosensitive. And then the next thing is predictive, because it has to provide more value by identifying the patterns and then give me some additional information. So the example about my friends that the Tesla informed about his wife's birthday got some predictive information about where he goes and then about his calendar information. So it has to be predictive and then provide more value than looking at his past experience or the past data set that it has stored. And then this generates something called a digital double. How it works, basically, there's a physical person, and then each and every physical person in this digital experience got a digital double or a digital representation inside the digital world. So it connects to databases, it connects to different systems, and then operate in a way. And I will explain in detail how it works. So the digital double operate in a place called a digital workspace. Digital workspace can be a computer, it can be a mobile device, or it can be any kind of a device that can talk to data and then provide set of data sets. Like it can be a vehicle, it can be a refrigerator, it can be any device that connect to a network and communicate. So that's called the digital workspace. So inside the digital workspace, this digital double operates, and it accesses social data, it accesses the business information, and then it access knowledge databases. So that's how the digital workspace works. So to give a real-world example about digital workspace, I took this thing. This is about a dating application. So I think in US, dating applications are really popular among the singles, and I believe it is like that here as well. So what happened in the dating applications, and why people like dating applications, because dating applications provide accurate matching. More than the traditional matchmakers, it provides better matching. That's why people use dating application. How it works, basically, it reads the information about that person from their social networks, and then it access different type of activities this person is doing, like what type of movie ticket he's buying, what type of music he's listening to. All this information gathered, and then create a profile about him. And then the once it gathered this set of data, these different type of digital doubles start talking in this digital workspace and then try to match each other. So what will happen, unfortunately, you will miss your first date, because usually when we do, when you go for a first date, that's a date that we talk about our likes, dislikes, which music you like to listen to, what type of movies you like to go and visit. So all these things will be missed because it's already done. So when you meet this person, we are having the second date because the digital doubles already completed the first date for you. So that's about how digital double works as well as a digital workspace works. So basically, even if you are having a nap, the digital doubles will be talking to each other and then operate in different digital workspaces. Then how the data or data will go into the end user. There are different layers. First, the physical person is there, and then he or she has to access application, and then applications are running on platforms, and platforms will connect through a network. So that's how the different layers will help to communicate with each other. And when it comes to different type of platforms, we identify social networks. So the first two actually cross with each other, like you can get web and mobile on those two spaces, but I categorize in this way. So social networks we access through web apps, and then games, geo apps type of stuff are very popular as mobile apps. And then the services like financial services, citizen services, those are kind of one-to-one because we don't share those services. Like I don't share my financial service if I have a joint account, yes, but otherwise we will not share it. So those things we call it as two-side platforms. And then things like healthcare, citizen services need information from other systems. We call that multi-site platforms because health information might need to connect with insurance, and then citizen services might need to connect with different type of government services. So those call multi-site platforms. And then the last one is the most popular thing. Things like smart cities, connected cars, smart hotels need to connect with many networks and then fetch information. So that's how these platforms are categorized. So the whole idea and the success behind the digital transformation or digital experience, it's about the interactions. So this I took this quote from Gartner. What they are advising, things less about the fixed processes, because we used to deal with a lot of fixed processes, and then we use the fixed processes to serve our customers. Without looking at it like that, think more about the dynamic interactions. That's what they are recommending to when you build applications and provide services to your consumers. Then this interaction, there are four categories. Interaction can happen human to machine. And then interaction can happen to machine, and interaction can happen to human, and machine to human. But unfortunately, digital transformation, digital experience provide a lot of flexibility and then a lot of advantages. But the main disadvantage, we will not have any human-to-human connection with this experience. It will be more machine-to-machine or machine-to-human. So I will share one experience with that as well. So I live in San Jose, and our office located in Mountain View. Usually, it's a 20 to 30 minute commute every day. So I usually leave home around 8 o'clock, and then drop my kids at school 8:30. And then, if the traffic is okay, I can be at office by 9 o'clock. So the Usually, thanks to our sales team, I get a couple of calls in the morning, and 9 o'clock I have a call in most of the time. So I want to be at office on time. And I'm a tea person. I like to drink tea. So after I have the morning tea, then I like to have a tea before I start work. And across the street, there's a Starbucks. So I usually cross the street and get a Starbucks. So the problem with Starbucks, everybody like to get a coffee or a tea in the morning before they go to work. So there are massive queues in the Starbucks. So I started avoiding going there because I can't afford it, because I had to be at office and take the call. And suddenly they released this version. Actually, it happened in last September, I guess. They released this application. They tagged it as No Time, No Line, exactly exactly match with my experience. That's what I want to avoid. So they released this app that I can order and go and pick up my coffee or tea. So I started using it. So since I usually go to this coffee shop, before they introduce this application, the experience is like that. You stand in the queue, and then they give the coffee, and usually they write the name in the coffee cup. So since they write my name daily, they know me, and then they call from my name, and then even they ask, like, how are you? And then if I don't show up for a time, they're asking, did you travel? Where did you travel? Kind of a good discussion. So after they introduced this system, they are not writing my name, and there are a lot of customers there as well. And suddenly they started calling me mobile order or the web order. So they shouted web order, and then I had to go and pick my cup and take my tea. So it's kind of a different experience. So that's where I like human-to-human interaction is less in this digital experience. Even it provides a lot of values to us. I think you might have experienced a lot of these type of situations. Then so digital experience today and digital enterprises, everybody talking about it, and analysts, everyone excited about it, and even that's your main goal as well, to build this stuff. But for us, we identified this need long time back, even before analysts talking about this concept. So it goes to 2010 June that we were working with a customer in the financial industry in San Francisco. Me and a couple of architects went there too for a consultancy. And there was a smart architect in this particular financial institute who read, there was a famous book called Practical SOA, very popular book those days. So he read this book, and then he was planning to build a SOA system. But one thing he mentioned during the first day, that I don't want to build a project, I want to build something that I can share across my organization, across my business units. So we came back to the hotel, and then I discussed with other architects, and we thought of, okay, let's look at it from a different way, and then let's propose a platform, and we call it as business service platform. And we identify there's a front-end business services gateway. It's not about APIs those days, it's just HTTP endpoints from SOAP or REST type of endpoints. So we call it as the business services gateway, and then the service component, like the actual services, business rules, so and so forth, we call them as business services. And then we thought of introduce a canonical data model. We call it as universal USM, or the universal service model. And backend data coming from different systems. So we introduced this MDM layer. Okay, you need to have MDM to get this data from different data sources and update it back to the different data sources. So this was the first version, and he was very happy, and he started implementing this. Then after that, in 2011, Sanjeeva asked me to pitch this concept to one person who was running the largest department store in Sri Lanka, and he asked me to pitch this thing. So I thought, like, that particular architecture that we identify is kind of not enough to pitch for this organization. So I started working on a new architecture, and then it came like this. So we name it as a business service platform, and then we identify four things. First is the current IT infrastructure, because we thought we have to reuse the current IT infrastructure. We should not recommend to replace everything. And then we thought we should consider the future IT strategies. What are the IT strategies that they are going to do? And then we identify the external communication, because you need to communicate with your external service consumers. And then we identify there are a lot of internal application groups are there. So how you can communicate internally and internal service consumers. So we pitch it, and then she was very happy about this thing and started implementing small projects by looking at this concept. So then Sanjeev asked me to write a book, but still I am writing it, so it might come at some point. So that was the second version of this thing we identified. Then In 2014, then Paul was our CTO and the co-founder, currently finishing his PhD, in sabbatical. So I worked with Paul, and then we identified this concept that some of the analysts talking about this thing, and then we should pay attention, but we didn't have enough time. But one of the customer actually from here, based in UK, and one customer based in Boston, the key architects from these customers, they told us there's a concept that we are interested in building our application. Why don't you guys look at it? So it's a strategy, basically, a conceptual level architecture pattern that they identify by having three. So Gartner identified it as three layers. First is called the system of record that contains all the data processes that you have, and top of that, something called system of differentiation that you build new ideas on top of that. And then system of innovation for the people who has like more cool ideas to come and build applications. So it's a three-layered architecture. And after that, the other analyst firm, they came up with a similar idea called system of engagement, system of record, and then system of automation. So both address the same thing, but in different angles. So these are like good, but at the strategy level. Then we discuss how we can make it more practical, and then build an enterprise architecture on top of that. So after that, we came up with this idea. I know it's a little bit complicated. So we identify this two-dimensional view of an enterprise architecture. So what are the essential stuff that should be there in the enterprise architecture? So we call this as system of systems, or the necessary middleware capabilities that a platform should have. So it's why I call it as a two-dimensional thing. On this level, like it explain about the functional capabilities, and the other level, it explain about the operational law, how the runtime will look like. So then we started pitching this to architects, and then I had kind of really productive discussions with architects by just putting this on the screen. So that's the next version. Then we thought, okay, this is the actual enterprise architecture, but it might be not helpful to explain it to everybody. So we simplify it by kind of encapsulating this core functional capabilities into platforms. So we call this as platform of platforms, that there are sub-platforms inside the overall platform. So they are like, we get the stuff like API management, integration, security, analytics, so on and so forth. All the necessary stuff, we group them into application for a person who got some kind of a business problem can come and quickly pick a sub-platform and start building applications. So then the next thing happened, so we identify what are the technical requirements we required, but when it comes to implementation, it's really hard to deal with non-technical stuff, because technical problems are really easy to solve, but there are non-technical stuff, how we can solve them. So then Sanjeeva gave me another challenge. In 2014, Europe, WSO2Con, we did it in Barcelona, and he asked me to do two sessions, one about a roadmap on technical side, how you build a connected business, we call during those days, and then the second session about the non-technical aspect of how you build a roadmap on that. We had some information, because while working with the customers, we identified these are the challenges a normal organization will have, but I thought of gather information, and then I started researching on this thing, and identified this book called Connected Company. So while I'm flying from San Francisco to Barcelona, I started reading this thing. Then I identify most of the things that we are doing explained in this book, as well as the Connected Company explaining in this book equal to what we are doing internally inside WSO2 as well. So from there, we identify some a lot of good practices that we can apply as non-technical area. So I will explain in detail at during the end of the slide deck. So I'll highly recommend this book if you want to learn and identify the non-technical aspect of this journey. Just get the book. It's available in digital as well as the hard paper format as well. So the experience, the stuff that we learned from building this application, that's what I'm going to cover during this session. The first one we identify as don't create projects, create a platform, because the scope and the strategy is bigger than a project. So you have to start and you have to build a platform. You can start small, but you have to start thinking it as a platform. Why we need a platform, basically, that provide a support structure that increase the efficiency of a community, because that's what we are trying to do. We are trying to build services, we are trying to build expose APIs, we are trying to build applications, so there's a community, and we need to have a platform to support that. So we call it as a platform as a government, because government provide different type of rules and control. Like that, a platform will provide technical standards as well as cultural standards, and then create a proper govern environment for us to build these solutions. So I used this slide during the strategy forum, but everybody was not there, so I will explain this again. So how a platform looks like in a typical organization. So you have the platform, and then there should be a platform team. The platform team should consist with several roles, a platform owner from the business side, enterprise and a platform architect who will look after the platform and enhance it, and then a platform specialist we call expert who can build quick POCs and then add functionalities into the platform. Since different people coming and building applications, platform should test quickly and properly. There should be test automation engineers associated with the platform. And then finally, you need to run this in dev test environments as well as production environments. So there should be an operational specialist or a DevOps person associated with the platform. So you have the platform. And then on top of the platform, you will have different projects. So you will start with a single project, and then you will increase the number of projects based on your requirements. And then each and every project will have a team as well. There's a project manager, and this important role called business architect, who will gather information, I mean the requirements, and then create test cases, do the documentation, so on and so forth. We call this, we used to call this role as a business analyst before. Like I think you guys deal with business analysts who provide 300, 400 documents that we never read. So that role has changed. And then this new role is a little bit technical, that provide useful information for an architect to architect application system. So addition to the business architect, you need a solutions architect and an application architect who will look at it from the business angle and architect your systems. And then you need integration engineers and implementation engineers. Number of integration engineers and implementation engineers will vary based on the scope of the project. And then you need to test your project, because platform will not take the core functionalities of your project, so you need QA engineers inside that as well. So this is kind of a model. It can vary based on the size and the scope of the platform you are building, as well as how your organization operate as well. But we identify most of the successful platforms we build kind of maintain this type of a structure. Then the next thing, the advice we would like to provide, your platform should provide rich functional capabilities, because each and every project that come and operate inside your platform might need different type of functional capabilities. If you don't provide that from your platform, they will try to go and build applications outside the platform. So that's the same thing happened some time back that we call as shadow IT, because of the constraints we had at the IT operational level. People go and build applications outside. So similar thing can happen if you don't provide enough functional capabilities. So I always advise, like, the platform should be ahead the projects and then provide these capabilities. That's why if you go back to the functional diagram that we call it a system of system, that's why it got a lot of boxes, because you need these functional capabilities to provide different application capabilities. Then it has to be seamlessly integrated, because we talk about the digital experience, how much information it provides for the consumer. So if you are not integrated, you can't provide that information for your consumers, because the information will not come from a single system. So it has to be seamlessly integrated internally, as well as it has to seamlessly integrated externally as well, because you might get information from other systems. Then the integration should be on top of API, so we call it as API-driven. So that's a fundamental of the platform. And then we recommend to have a top-down approach. Most of the systems develop like identify set of data, and then write a service, expose as an API, and then we ask people to use the API. Most of the time, it might be not useful even, because we didn't look at the requirements. So what we are recommending, do it in the other way. Identify the consumer need, design your APIs, and then go and look at how you can get this data and hand over to the consumer. So even I did tweet this thing some time back about like how you should design the services. It's not about the success of SOA, it's not about efficient services, it's about it's an architecture design around the consumers and experience. The same principle apply here as well. We need to consider the consumer experience and then design these systems. So from the day one, your APIs will be used by some kind of an application. So that's a very successful way of show ROI quickly, as well as get your API is popular inside your organization. Then the nature of this software development and application development we are in, we need to do rapid application development and quick releases. So without automation and without building tools, we can't do. So as a part of the platform, we need to build the tools, and then we need to automate as much as possible. Like, we have to automate the testing, we have to automate the build processes, we have to automate the provisioning of your containers or your VMs. So everything need to be automated and provide it as a service from the platform for application groups to use. Then this is another thing and a trick that we tell the customers: give a code name to the platform. And we recommend not to use any vendor or a product names, because people are very religious about these type of things. So they will not come and use it because it call as a ESB or some kind of a vendor name. So we recommend to use a code name. And one thing very popular is they call these platforms as digital platforms, but you can give any name and call it. So that's one success factor. Then the next thing is, it's not enough to build a platform and put it into production. You need to have a proper onboarding program, because it should have samples, it should have documentation, and then you have to define, that's the governance coming into the picture, what are the patterns and what are the practices that should have in this particular platform. Those things should be documented, and not only documented, you should provide training for different groups to learn this stuff and provide a proper onboarding program. The next thing is you have to evangelize the platform internally. Then only people will identify. If there are any newsletters internally, you can use that. If there are any kind of wiki pages, you can update those stuff. And then you can provide sessions, like we call them as architecture boot camps. Addition to that, you can do developer boot camps or hackathons internally, and then get your platform, educate internal people and get them to use your platform. So that's another thing that you should do. Then you should have a common enterprise architecture practice across the organization, but it should not defined only by the central enterprise architecture team. Then again, people will be reluctant to use this thing. So the advice is to include architects from different business units when you define this common architecture practice in your organization. And the next, you have to have a central architecture principle, but you should operate, or we call it as, it has to be a podular architecture. A pod is a small group, like we call it in the application development level, call something like a scrum team. Those are the pods that we will have in this architecture that will provide a specific functionality. It can be set of services, it can be set of APIs, and they will operate as small pods. So some of the organizations will not design to operate podularly. So what you can do, you can create virtual pods, like HR level or the organization level. It might be a different structure, but you can create virtual pods and then create these small scrum teams and let them to operate in that level. Then iterative, because even Sanjeev explained this thing about how you have to be iterative. You will not build the entire platform at once. You will divide it into different small chunks and then develop it on with the time. So that's called iterative approach. So iterative development is a common thing that a lot of people are doing, but iterative architecture is something new, and we are highly promoting it as well as educating our customers how you can have an iterative approach and build this thing with the time. Then the next thing, I think this is what we discussed more during this conference about different technologies. You can utilize these edge technologies like IoT, because IoT is a must, how you connect with these devices, collect data. And then cloud, container, those things are really helpful. And then MSA or the microservices architecture, not only the microservices, Itabus micro integration, all these best practices can bring, and big data. So those things can be utilized heavily. Then the difficult part about people, how you can engage people to the new platform, because there's a resistance. If people don't like to change, whenever there's a change comes, they are reluctant to do that. So how you can come across with that, basically, you have to engage them, and then you have to empower them, and you have to entrust them. So that's one thing that we identified. And when we are doing this architecture discussions and decision-making meetings, there are a lot of resistance coming without a reason. Why they are not sure whether they will be part of the new platform. So we need to make sure that each and every person has a role and a responsibility, and then we need to bring them as part of the platform development team. So to do that, actually, you should have a open system. We call it as an open system, because a closed system can't provide that for the people work in these projects. So I think if you listen to Sanjeev, first day Sanjeev explained how WSO2 operates with open mailing list, and then how even a junior person can bring their ideas and implement even a product. So that's called an open system. So you should have a proper open system to manage people and then bring them into a platform like this. So the Dave Gray, actually, the guy who wrote that book, he wrote a blog about microservices. So I went there and put a comment. Dave, I find it difficult to avoid at least one quote from your book, The Connected Company, that's a book, when delivering a public talk. And immediately, 2 seconds after that, Dave replied by telling, "Hey, Asanka, anyone interested in creating a connected company should be looking at technologies like microservices and at company like WSO2, a truly connected organization and a great example to follow." Because Dave joined us and spent 3 days during the US conference, and he identified how we operate. He talked to all the engineers. So it was a great comment that we got from Dave. So to summarize, because we got a little bit distracted with Dave. So why a platform and what are the advantages? So the first thing is traffic brings customers and customers bring revenue. And then infrastructure allow to focus on the differentiation, because now you have a platform, you don't need to worry about the low-level technical stuff. You can focus on the business side and then build the innovative ideas and then make differentiation. And then since it provides governance, standard and patterns, it provide or bring trust to the system. So that is about the platform. So we are coming to the end of my session. So basically, the idea we had individually you, like to be the person who led the digital transformation or who's leading the digital transformation by educating you to make you that person in your organization if you are in the senior leadership role. But even if you are not, even you will be a part of this digital transformation. So that is one goal we had. The second goal, to make your organization a digital enterprise by adding these best practices and provide a better experience for your end consumers. And then as WSO2, what we want to be, not a typical vendor, but we want to be a technology partner of your digital journey, sorry, and then the work with you from the inception of your project and then provide architecture guidance as well as technology behind our platform and help you to succeed and make your enterprise a digital enterprise. That's it, and I hope it was useful, and thank you.